please remain standing for the playing of the national anthem. Jason Elcock, the Manager of Corporate Communications here at the Parliament, and I have the very simple task of serving as Master of Ceremonies today and to introduce the various speakers for today's presentation. And I begin right now by inviting to the podium to deliver introductory remarks the President of the Senate, Senator the Honorable Christine Kangalu.
Thank you very much, Chair. Honorable Speaker of the House, Mrs. Bridget Anisette George, Cabinet Ministers, Members of Parliament, former presiding officers, Mr. Michael Williams, Mr. Timothy Hamill-Smith, Mr. Barry Sinanan, permanent secretaries, department heads, representatives of the regional corporations and of state enterprises, specially invited guests, members of the media, and all other distinguished persons present here. My task this evening is as simple as it is short. It is to welcome you all to this evening's lecture and to introduce our speaker, Professor Frederick Stapenhurst. This evening's lecture takes place in a specific context. This is the context. Recent studies on the effectiveness of parliaments in holding governments to account in their administration of the affairs of states have found that parliaments have not been exercising their oversight capacity to the fullest potential. Our parliament is no exception. In response to these findings, our parliament has embarked on a series of initiatives geared towards the improvement of the operations of the committee system through deepening awareness and appreciation for parliamentary oversight and scrutiny. This evening's lecture is the first event in a week of activities aimed at engendering dialogue and increasing public awareness of the work of parliamentary committees. This evening's lecture precedes 2 days of workshops to be held tomorrow and Thursday for members of parliament and for members of the media. This evening's speaker, Professor Frederick Stapenhurst, is an expert on the effectiveness of parliaments and the work of parliamentary committees. This is his expertise. Professor Stapenhurst is a professor of practice at the Institute for the Study of International Development at McGill University in Canada. He's currently leading 2 research projects, one examining public financial management in Francophone countries, and the other involving the setting up of a global network of parliamentary budget offices. Under his leadership, McGill University, in collaboration with development partners, has launched a university-certified international executive development program for parliamentary staff. He is an associate professor in the political science department in another university where he guides the establishment of a French language professional development program for parliamentary staff, and he's involved in developing a major research project on global financial oversight. For more than a decade, he was team leader of the World Bank Institute's highly regarded parliamentary strengthening program, and he has played a central role in the development and implementation of the governance and anti-corruption program more generally. He retired from that role in July 2010 and is currently a part-time parliamentary advisor and consultant to the World Bank. He has led many parliamentary needs assessment missions in Africa, Asia, and Eastern Europe, and has organized and delivered numerous training courses and executive development seminars for legislators and legislative staff. Over the course of his long and distinguished career, he has developed strong partnerships with units inside the World Bank and with multilateral institutions, international organizations, and non-governmental civil society organizations as well as with bilateral donors and national parliaments. He has written extensively on the area of the effectiveness of parliaments and the work of parliamentary committees. His writings are too extensive for me to attempt describing them this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, it is at one and the same time my honor and my privilege to give you Professor Frederick Stapenhurst.
Madam President, Madam Speaker, Senators, Honorable Members, honored guests, all due protocol accepted, it is my great pleasure to be here with you this week and especially this evening. I feel after an introduction as good as that, I can't possibly live up to that, but I'll do my best. Could I have the next slide, please? If you don't mind, I'm not going to stay at the podium. I feel 2 hours of your valuable time at the end of a busy day listening to somebody stand at a lectern, I can't think of anything worse, anything more boring, so I'll try and be a little bit more informal, if you don't mind. This is what I'm going to talk about today. I want to, first of all, give you a little bit of background and ask you some questions. I'd like this to be an interactive session. I want to ask you some questions about Trinidad and Tobago. I'm then going to talk about what I think is one of the outputs of parliamentary oversight, which is corruption, lower corruption. I'm going to talk about parliamentary oversight. I'm going to talk about public accounts committees. And then I'm going to conclude with possibly what I should have started with is, does any of this matter? And I hope that you'll agree with me at the end of the session that indeed it does matter. Could I have the next slide, please? So I'd like to ask you first, I just arrived in Trinidad and Tobago a couple of days ago. What is the biggest problem facing the country? Anybody? The crime situation, and what else, please?
Law and order.
Law and order. Thank you. Thank you. Corruption. And that's what I'm going to focus on. And in this regard, certainly Trinidad and Tobago is not unique. Corruption is a problem that affects every country in the world. Even the countries that are declared to be the least corrupt have some corruption. But this isn't a lecture on corruption, it's a lecture on parliamentary oversight. So I won't go too much into corruption, but just a little bit. Next slide, please. I'd like to start with a scenario. And this is where I would like us to be particularly interactive. I want you to imagine that it's late one night, and you were walking across to your car in a deserted parking lot. Now, forgetting for a moment the possibility of crime, you're walking to your car, there's nobody around, it's late at night, and you see on the ground an envelope. And you pick up the envelope, and there are no markings on it. It's a plain white envelope. You look inside, and there are 100 US dollar bills inside. So you think, who could have lost this? This is a lot of money. And you look around, and there's nobody there. So you can't possibly trace who this belongs to. Now, what would you do? You have two options. Number one, you say, can we go to the next slide, please? What would you do? Would you go to the nearest police station and say, I found this envelope at the parking lot, and I'd like to hand this in, and somebody might claim it? Or would you put the envelope in your pocket and saying, well, somebody else's loss is my gain, and nobody will know because there's nobody around? So I would like a show of hands. How many of you would go to the police station and hand the envelope in? I think about maybe five people, and Jeff, but I know Jeff well enough that I don't believe him. Okay, all right, maybe six people. All right, this is a fairly common response. I use this scenario in many lectures in Canada and elsewhere. But there's a second part to this story. Could we have the next slide, please? It's a second scenario. And the second scenario is the same as the first. You're walking to your car late at night, deserted parking lot. But this time, because of crime, the concerns of crime, there is a closed-circuit television camera in the parking lot. So you're walking to your car, you find an envelope, you look at the car, no markings on it, you look inside, and there are 10, oh, excuse the mistake here, 10 $100 bills. So it's 1,000 US dollars. You look around, there's nobody there. Next slide, please. Now what would you do? How many of you would now take this money to the police station, knowing that whatever you do is going to be recorded on CCTV camera? How many of you would hand this money in? Could I have a show of hands, please? Well, it's maybe a few more than before. Okay. I'm glad it's not a few less, because... Okay, next slide, please. So, and next slide again, please. All right, and let's just get this till we get the whole thing up. And one more. There is a well-known anti-corruption guru, one of the first people who started serious work on anti-corruption. His name is Robert Clickguard. He was a professor at Harvard, and he became president of Claremont University in California. And he came up with this equation. He said corruption exists, without the T at the end, I've added that more recently. He said corruption exists when public officials have monopoly power, only they can make decisions that affect financial matters. They have discretion in applying that power, and they lack accountability. And I would add that corruption also exists when there's a lack of transparency. So corruption exists when there's monopoly power, when public officials have monopoly power, they have discretion, they lack accountability, and they lack transparency. And so, Professor Klitgaard argued, if you want to reduce corruption, it's quite simple. You reduce the monopoly power that public officials have, you reduce their discretion, you increase their accountability, and you increase transparency, or any combination of those. It sounds simple. Next slide, please. So first of all, we have to think, let's take a pause, what do we actually mean by corruption? A short definition that Transparency International, an NGO to fight corruption, has used, and I like this definition because it's short and simple. Corruption is the abuse of public office for private gain. So when a public official is not serving the public, but serving himself or herself. Could I have the next slide, please? It's worth noting that there's nothing new about corruption. As far back as 300 years before Christ, Kautilya, who was then prime minister and emperor of Chandragupta of India, identified 40 ways of embezzlement of public funds by public employees. And he had this to say about government officials. Just as it is impossible not to taste the honey or the poison that finds itself on the tip of the tongue, so it is impossible for a government servant not to eat up at least a little bit of the king's revenue. Which made me think that if corruption isn't the world's oldest profession, it's at least its second oldest profession. Could I have the next slide, please? All right, so this may be interesting or not. I mean, I find this fascinating. But why should we be concerned about corruption? And if corruption is inevitable, if it's been around for two centuries, you know, do we need to be concerned? Why don't we just live with corruption? Next slide, please. That was the position of the World Bank until 20 years ago. We can't do anything about corruption. We shouldn't do anything about corruption. It's a political issue. We're not going to get involved with anything to do with corruption, except, of course, we know that finance from anywhere involves corruption. And Jim Wolfensohn, who was then president of the World Bank, just got elected president of the World Bank, wanted us to prove that corruption impacted development. And we came up with this diagram. And along this axis, and for those of you who are not statisticians, this is the only diagram I use of this type. Along this diagram, we use Transparency International's measure of corruption. This is low levels of corruption, and this is high levels of corruption. And we also measure economic growth per person, GDP per capita, GDP growth per capita, economic growth per person. And we measure from minus 2.5% a year up to 8%. And you see that generally speaking, the less corrupt a country is, the higher its rate of economic growth. There's a fairly good correlation here. And that was the start, 20 years ago, this kind of analysis that made economists and others realize that if we want to develop, we want to help countries develop, we better focus on corruption. There seems to be a clear correlation. We better understand what this is all about. So you find countries like Singapore and Hong Kong and Chile and Malaysia and so on have higher growth than countries like Kenya and Nigeria and Philippines. The exceptions, there's always exceptions, China, Korea, and Thailand. But what's happened in recent years to those three countries? Well, first of all, China and Thailand have had much slower growth, in part because of corruption. And now we see in China much lower growth as well. Although the Chinese had a good policy, to a good strategy to help curb corruption, anybody who was found to be corrupt, they shot. Next slide, please. Without going into too many details, I don't want to belabor the point, and I don't want to get into too much of a discussion in terms of economic impact or development impact. But we see, for example, that better governance, including lower corruption, is associated with a lot of good things. We see, for example, that when there's good control of corruption, there's low levels of infant mortality. I'm not talking about cause and effect, I'm just saying that there's an association. Where the regulatory burden is good, you have higher levels of per capita income than where there's a weak regulatory burden, where officials have more discretion and monopoly power. You see where citizens have voice and governments are accountable, where voice and accountability is strong, you have higher per capita incomes than in countries where it's weak. And finally, where there's a good rule of law, there's higher levels of literacy. And again, I'm not talking cause and effect here, I'm just talking about association. Next slide, please. All right, well, using that as a starting point, I started about maybe 10 years ago doing some serious research on parliamentary oversight and corruption, back when I was working at the World Bank. And we found that control of corruption, or let me rephrase this, differences in levels of corruption around the world, 178 countries, differences in corruption explain 78% of the differences in GNP per capita. In other words, governments that want to improve standards of living, gross national income per capita, need to control corruption. Next slide, please. Now, out of 178 countries, in terms of Transparency International's ranking of countries on the corruption scale, just like the one I showed you on the graph, Transparency International now does assessments for 178 countries, perceived levels of corruption. Where do you think Trinidad and Tobago are on Transparency International's list of 178 countries? Sorry? 78. Actually, you're right, I think. Can we go to the next slide, please? It's 85th. So in terms of the 178 countries in the world, Trinidad and Tobago rates 85th in terms of corruption. It's slightly behind, it does slightly worse than El Salvador, slightly better than Liberia, and is on par with the Philippines, Sri Lanka, and Thailand. I was shocked when I was preparing for this lecture and I knew I was coming to Trinidad and Tobago. I, of course, did a lot of research, and I was surprised. Next slide, please. Furthermore, over the last 15 years, Trinidad and Tobago's score has generally gone down, leveled off in recent years, but generally has declined. So, whereas some countries are doing better at fighting corruption, Trinidad and Tobago doesn't appear to be one of those. Next slide, please. Yeah. You were probably thinking, when is he going to start talking about parliamentary oversight? I thought this was not about corruption. Well, let's switch to parliamentary oversight. I knew that Mrs. Sampson would be really annoyed with me if I didn't finally get round to parliamentary oversight. So when we think about parliamentary oversight, there are two things, two components of parliamentary oversight. What we call parliamentary oversight tools and mechanisms, those institutions, those mechanisms that parliaments have to oversee governments, and contextual factors, the environment within which parliament operates. The tools and mechanisms include some mechanisms which are inside parliament, such as the committee system, party and party groups, the chamber and the operations within the chamber, operations like questions, interpellations and debates. In addition, there may be commissions of inquiry that parliament sets up, or review of appointments within the executive. Another tool, important tool, but not part of Parliament, is our accountability institutions, like the Supreme Audit Institution, the Auditor General, the Ombuds Office, or anti-corruption agencies. And usually, not usually, often, these institutions report to Parliament so that Parliament can act on their findings. And then there's the context within which Parliament operates. Political parties, social legitimacy, how much trust do people have in Parliament, the electoral system, and the constitutional powers, the form of government. Does the country have a parliamentary form of government, a presidential form of government, or a hybrid system? Next slide, please. I want to focus now on those tools and mechanisms, first of all. Can I just go back for a second? So I'm going to focus on these issues for a moment. Okay, next one. Let me just check where I am in my presentation here. I think this is where I wanted to ask you a question. Yes, which parliamentary oversight tools does Trinidad and Tobago have? Does Parliament have here in Port of Spain? Can I go back to... So, of these, certainly has committees, parties and party groups, question periods, interpellations. Interpellations are sort of like question period, but much more in-depth questioning. I'll come back to that in a minute. Commissions of inquiry, do you have that? Review of appointments, that's usually in presidential systems. You have an Auditor General, you have an Ombuds Office, and you have an Anti-Corruption Bureau. Okay, so sounds as if you've got most of the tools. Next slide, please. Next one. In fact, when I was doing my review, I found, yes, indeed, the legislature here does have hearings. It has hearings and debates in plenary. It has commissions of inquiry, question period. I wasn't sure about interpellations. I've subsequently found, I think, that it doesn't, but nonetheless. Parliamentary committees, MPs, do undertake field visits and missions. There's an Ombuds Office, and there's an Auditor General. So in other words, Trinidad and Tobago have all of the tools to carry out effective oversight. So you think, wow, that's pretty impressive. A lot of countries only have some of these. My colleague Jeff Dubrow was telling us yesterday, in St. Lucia, they haven't had committee hearings or committee meetings for PAC, the Public Accounts Committee, for 15 years. So, but in Trinidad and Tobago, you have nearly all of these. Next slide, please. So Trinidad and Tobago stacks up pretty well when it comes to oversight tools. So let's have a look at the contextual factors, the other factors, that environment within which Parliament operates. And there are four main factors. Party existence of political parties, which I'm not going to go into because it's very difficult to analyze. The form of government, the type of electoral system, and social legitimacy in parliament. These are factors that impact very much how effective parliament can be. Next slide, please. Well, we'll come back to this later because this was a big surprise to me. Trust in parliament in Trinidad and Tobago is really low. I'm sure I'm not telling you anything new, but it surprised me. You know, why is this? The electoral system, you have a first-past-the-post system, you have a parliamentary form of government, your parliamentary research facilities, the library and librarians. As I was doing the research, I thought it was adequate. Having come here, I know it's adequate. And your committee staff are more than adequate. I mean, they're pretty impressive. So it seems that contextual factors, Trinidad and Tobago doesn't too badly either, except perhaps on social legitimacy. Next slide, please. So we then focus down on one of the issues that I think is particularly important, which is parliamentary oversight committees. Next slide, please. For those of you at the back that can't see this, for those of you who are on the radio that can't see this, I apologize. But this is a diagram that I think nicely summarizes for those people who haven't thought about this before, and I know members and senators are very aware of this, but for people who are not in Parliament, I think this is useful to think about public financial accountability. And there are three main actors. There's Parliament at the top, and I put in brackets the Public Accounts Committee, but Parliament, the Executive, and the Auditor General. And for public finance, well, first of all, Parliament confers power on the Executive. The executive is from the legislature, the party that gets the most seats forms the executive, and of course the executive can only operate with the confidence of parliament. So the executive is accountable to parliament. Many of my former colleagues at the World Bank thought that the executive was accountable to the Auditor General, and I used to tell them, no, the executive is accountable to parliament. And the role of the Auditor General is to examine the accounts of the executive, the public accounts, and report to Parliament. And the PAC should be taking action. So what the PAC is doing, in effect, what Parliament is doing generally, is holding government to account. And in terms of finances, it's using the Auditor General's report and the Public Accounts Committee as the two institutions, the two key institutions to do that. Next slide, please. So, I'm one of those people who gets really excited by public accounts committees. Now, all of my friends say, oh, he's not going on about public accounts committees again, is he? But I think they're so important. And I've done a lot of research and analysis to look at what makes public accounts committees effective around the world. Looked at about 80 parliaments, 100 parliaments around the world. And I've looked at structure, how PACs are structured. I've looked at capacity, what capacity do public accounts committees have, and I've looked at their activities. So can I have the next? So looking at structure, first of all. Next slide. I'm simplifying this because you're not taking a master's degree in parliaments and parliamentary governance. This is a public lecture. So I'm just going to look at a couple of variables in terms of each of those structure, mandate, and so on. In terms of number of members on Public Accounts Committee, there's quite a variation around the world. We find in Africa, for example, the average size of a PAC is 11 members. In Asia, it's 19. In Australia and New Zealand, it's 8. In the British Isles, it's 10, and so on. In Trinidad and Tobago, it's 10. So it's comparable with the global average. But not only is it comparable with the global average, but the former clerk of the New Zealand legislature wrote a really good book called The Overseers, the first comprehensive book on public accounts committees about 10 years ago. And he said the ideal size for a PAC is between 6 and 11 members. Any less than 6, it's too small to function properly. Any more than 11, it becomes difficult to manage, as I'm sure the chairs of committees in the room will appreciate. But Trinidad's right there within the ideal size. Next, please. In terms of the Caribbean, your neighbors, Jamaica has a larger PAC. Barbados has a larger PAC. But again, you're about the same as the average of your neighboring countries. Of course, Grenada, St. Lucia have much smaller PACs. They're much smaller parliaments. Next, please. So in general, and just looking at those two variables, Trinidad and Tobago stacks up pretty well in terms of structure of PACs. You'd say it's meeting the characteristics of global best practice. Next slide, please. So what about capacity? If the structure of PAC is pretty good, what about its capacity? And here, I've looked at just two variables for this study, and I've looked at many more, but the two that seemed to be important were, first of all, next slide, please. We're looking at the powers to examine government accounts. Does the PAC have the power to examine all government accounts, or a part of government's accounts restricted and Parliament doesn't have access to those? And of course, here I know you have two oversight committees, the Public Accounts Committee and the Public Accounts Enterprises Committee. But and between the two of them, I looked at that. And also access to information. In some countries, the PAC may have the power, the constitutional power, to examine accounts, but it doesn't have the right of access. Government entities aren't required to give Parliament their accounts or to appear before committees. So you think, how can governments be held to account if the PAC doesn't have the power and it doesn't have access? Next slide, please. I've got lots of tables there, but I don't want to bore you with that. But what I do want to say is Trinidad and Tobago oversight committees compare with the best of the world, best in the world regarding capacity. So you think, well then, thinking back to the earlier slide, so how come Trinidad and Tobago is doing so poorly in terms of combating corruption? Next slide, please. What's the problem? Next slide, please. So we look at activities. All right, we know there's a committee, we know it has the right structure, we know it has the right powers. So what about, what is it actually doing? Next slide, please. And again, I'm simplifying greatly here, but looking at a couple of characteristics, a couple of variables, we look at the number of meetings that the committee have. In Asia, the average for PACs is 18 meetings a year. In the British Isles, it's 21. In Canada, it's 16. In the Pacific, it's 90. Now, Africa doesn't do so well here. It's only 3. In TNT, it's not bad. It's It might not be up as high as the Asian average or the British Isles average, but it's certainly not as low as other Caribbean countries or Africa, sort of in between. Next, please. Sorry, go back. This is 10. Oops, 10. Thank you. Next slide, please. What about the number of meetings then? Jamaica has far more meetings, PAC has far more meetings than any other PAC in the region. It has 18, Grenada has 3, TNT has 10. But nonetheless, all to say, it's pretty active. Not quite as active as Jamaica, but pretty active. Next slide, please. So then we think of, what about hearings? How many public hearings do the committees hold? How do they engage with the public? How many witnesses do they call to give testimony? And here, again, we find that the committees in TNT do pretty well. Not quite as high as in the British Isles or in Canada or in the Pacific, although the Pacific is an anomaly. This average is driven up by Fiji, but pretty respectable. So next slide, please. And this is just giving the Caribbean numbers in more detail. Next slide, please. So then we come down to number of reports. How productive is the committee? It has meetings, it has hearings. So there's a lot of activity, but what's the output of that activity? And here, I think, is the crux of the problem. Because in Asia, this is looking at number of reports produced by a PAC. In Asia, PACs produce, on average, 11 reports a year, one a month. Sorry, this is a little bit off. This should be British Isles, it's 16. In the Pacific, it's 9. Now, when I say that in Canada, it's 4, I know that Jeff will say, but look, there's a reason for that. And it's not just that the PACs may not be productive, it's because Canada does omnibus reports. But here, clearly, TNT is not performing so well. 2 reports a year or 3 reports a year is well below the global average. Maybe we're onto something here. Next slide, please. So, TNT PAC holds meetings, public hearings, but this activity does not relate into the number of reports submitted and debated in Parliament. Now, does this matter? I mean, surely reports just go and sit on a shelf, or perhaps the government acknowledges the report but doesn't do anything. Well, does it matter? So next slide, please. Well, this was a piece of analysis that really surprised me, that we look at control of corruption and we look at number of PAC reports. And in fact, there's a direct correlation. Those countries where PACs produce more reports have greater control of corruption than those that don't. And this is just a sampling of countries. We've actually got 80 or 90 countries in the sample. Next slide, please. Now, I said I'd come back to this, or if I didn't, I meant to say that I'd come back to this. So this is looking at path analysis. And we're looking at the productivity of public accounts committees, the number of reports produced. And we find that the number of the activity, the productivity of PAC, as measured by reports produced, so very simple, accounts for 42% of the differences in corruption across countries. And as I explained earlier, control of corruption accounts for 70% of GNI per capita. So if you want higher standards of living, if you want lower levels of corruption, you need to have a productive PAC. Next slide, please. In short, there's a demonstrated link between public accounts activity and public accounts committee output. PAC effectiveness is a cause and not a consequence of good governance. In other words, it's not that lower corruption or better governance increases public accounts committee effectiveness. It's the other way round. Next slide, please. Now, this would be my hypothesis. Having done all of this analysis, I would say that the reason why TNT levels of corruption are so high is because the Public Accounts Committee, while active, does not complete its work by producing reports, submitting them to Parliament, and having them debated. Now, this may also explain why there's low public trust in Parliament. If the public don't see Parliament undertaking its oversight work, and they see that they may not know because of that, but because of that, corruption is high, well, it's not surprising, perhaps, that trust in Parliament is low. But then, why is that? Next slide, please. Well, there are two reasons. First of all, members of Parliament may lack the political will to undertake effective oversight work. It could be that members of Parliament don't care about oversight. It may mean that they don't care about corruption. And they just are in Parliament to have a good time and to pick up a paycheck. Or it could mean that MPs do not have sufficient time to undertake effective work. Now, my suggestion would be that I don't think members of Parliament are any less serious about their work in Trinidad and Tobago than in any other country. In which case, I have to look at the amount of time that parliamentarians have to undertake effective work, their work. Can I have the next slide, please? Yes, so assuming that MPs in TNT are fundamentally no different than MPs elsewhere, we must look at the workload of MPs and their availability of time to undertake their oversight work. And then, when I dug further, I was surprised that TNT is one of the few countries where members of Parliament are part-time. Now, I've worked in maybe 80 parliaments around the world, and I've met thousands of members of Parliament, and I would say that apart from the very, very few who don't take their job seriously, I would say the workload of an average member of Parliament is 60, 70, 80 hours a week. And yet here, in Trinidad and Tobago, they're hired part-time. Well, that got me thinking. Other than Parliament, what is the great Trinidad and Tobago institution? Can anybody give me something that is world-class in Trinidad and Tobago that you're very proud of? Oh, Carnival. Okay, well, Carnival, certainly, but besides Carnival. So anybody else? Well, I would have said cricket. Cricket.
Used to be,
okay. I can just imagine headlines now. But now, how good would your cricket team be competing internationally if all your cricketers had other jobs and were trying to do cricket in part-time? I mean, it wouldn't be performing very well, I don't think. Perhaps even worse. I don't know. I don't want to be quoted on cricket scores. It couldn't be worse. Well, I don't know. Next slide, please. So it seems to me, I'm going to begin to wrap up now. I have no idea how much time I've taken, probably far too long. It seems to me that the poor outcomes of parliamentary oversight in this country are attributable to the fact that MPs are unable to complete their work because of time pressures. This lack of output from oversight activities likely explains the high level of corruption in TNT. So, next slide, please. All right, so this then begs the question, how does TNT score? Well, we said it's the 85th in the world, but Trinidad and Tobago are small island states. They're different from other countries. So I looked at the Caribbean, the English-speaking Caribbean. Well, I looked at the whole Caribbean. And Barbados ranks 17th from the top in terms of corruption, better than the United States. Its score out of 100 was 74. Transparency International Corruption Perceptions Index, I think it was 2014. Bahamas ranked 24th in the world with a score of 71. And then St. Vincent, Puerto Rico, Dominica, Cuba, Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago were both tied, 85th and a score of 38. Suriname and Guyana were not far behind Jamaica and Trinidad at a score of 36 and 35. And the only country doing significantly worse in terms of control of corruption is Haiti. Now, so this came as a bit of a shock to me. I mean, I would have thought that TNT would have been higher up the scale. Now, what would the world be like if TNT was doing better? Can I have the next slide, please? I think this is my last. Well, on this side, it's definitely my last slide, but on this side, if 20 years ago, TNT's level of corruption could have been reduced to that of Puerto Rico. I'm not talking about Finland or New Zealand, I'm talking about Puerto Rico. 20 years ago, if corruption had been reduced to that level, GDP per capita today would be 15% higher. In other words, national income per person would be, instead of about $20,000, US dollars, it would be about $23,000. Now, if I was a citizen of Trinidad and I thought, boy, my salary, my income could be 15% better if Trinidad and Tobago could control corruption better, I'd be rooting for better control of corruption. And if I just listened to my lecture, I'd say, let's strengthen Public Accounts Committee. Now, but is Puerto Rico the standard that TNT would like to be held to? If corruption could have been reduced further to that of Barbados or Bahamas, real GDP per capita would be 20 to 25% higher. In other words, between $24,000 and $25,000. And with that, I'd like to end, because I think this speaks volumes. And for any citizen, I can't imagine any citizen that wouldn't want to have higher standards of living. And certainly, I can't imagine anybody who would vote for somebody who isn't advocating this. And I doubt if any members of Parliament would have thought before that parliamentary oversight wasn't important. But if there were any, I would hope that I've convinced you otherwise. And with that, let me stop and open for questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Stapenhurst. As Professor indicated, we will have a question and answer period now. I'd like to thank you, Professor, for what I'm sure will initiate a very robust question and answer period, and thank you for your insights today. This is for our external audience as well. We also have the facility for persons to connect with us via social media. The Parliament has a Twitter account, which is at TT Parliament. You can send messages there. You can go to our Facebook page, facebook.com/TT Parliament, as well as our YouTube feed, at which there's a chat live there where you can place your questions as well. And we already have two questions online for Professor Stapenhurst. So at about this time, we'll begin the question and answer period. A microphone is going to be placed, all right? One of our techs has a microphone. So if you have a question for Professor on the topic that he presented today, you can simply raise your hand and someone will come to you and we can get the Q&A going.
I only have one request, and that is keep the question simple.
We'd like also, if you can just give us your name, so the professor can call you by name. Well, or if you represent an organization, you can tell us who you represent.
My name is Runa Rogers. My question, Professor, is has your study taken into consideration the support by technocrats to the MPs in relation to output, and output in so far as reporting is concerned?
Yes, indeed, it did. I mean, a very good question, thank you. And when we dig further, and there was a lot more information I could have shared with you, one of the things that makes PAC productive, besides MPs having enough time, is there being sufficient support staff and research staff supporting not just PAC but the other committees as well. And here I must commend the Parliament of Trinidad and Tobago, because I think it's made great strides in recent years to beef up its staffing to support members across the board, including and in particular in committees. Yes. Oh.
Franklin Khan, on your slide on Barbados's performance in Public Accounts Committee, it was extremely bad. For the number of meetings they kept, the number of reports, it was probably the only countries that performed worse than Barbados was, I think, St. Lucia and somebody else. So it doesn't jive with your conclusion. So can you try to attempt to explain that out?
Yeah, that is a good question. I was hoping that that question wouldn't be asked. I think there's something particular about very small states. I think they're easier to govern. Now, I've had discussions with people here about whether TNT is a small state. Population here is just over 1.3 million. I think most organizations would classify small states as either less than 500,000 or less than 1,000,000. Now, I don't want to minimize the problems of a relatively small state, and I don't want to go into the debates, but when you have a population as small as in Barbados, I think governance becomes easier. You have a problem, you pick up the phone and phone the Prime Minister. Probably not so easy here to do that.
Question.
Timothy Hammersmith. I think you're right about the question of the not whole-time parliamentarians acting. Obviously, they don't have the time, and we do need to ensure, and I think there are many voices that have said we need whole-time parliamentarians. But have you considered there was a report of the Royal Commission in New Zealand which suggests that you need at least 100 non-executive parliamentarians in order to make the committee system work. So have you considered the impact on the numbers of parliamentarians on the effectiveness of our parliamentary committee system?
I mentioned earlier the report done by David McGee, the former clerk of the New Zealand legislature, who wrote what was initially, I felt, Public Accounts Committee 101. It came out of a Commonwealth Parliamentary Association study group looking at how public accounts committees work across the Commonwealth. It was very descriptive, whereas our more recent work has been more analytical. At that study group, which had representatives from every group, every region of the Commonwealth, including the Caribbean and including the Pacific, two regions with small island states, the conclusion was that parliaments that have less than 60 members face particular difficulties. Now, you're bicameral here, and if we add members and senators together, you go get above the 60, not by an awful lot, I admit, but you have at least somewhat above that threshold.
The floor is open for more questions.
Yes, my name is James Armstrong. I appreciate the analysis, but I was really looking forward to, as stated in the title, a model, just trying to get to a model. And I was wondering whether we can touch on what might be some of the possibilities. One question is whether, in fact, it might be possible to co-opt non-parliamentarians into the committee.
Look, again, great question. In fact, a great question and a great comment. This lecture is the start of deliberations developing or moving towards a model. In fact, we're meeting with members of parliament over the next 2 days, and that's one of the issues on the agenda, to take this kind of global analysis and not just put it within a small state context, but within the TNT context. But second, and it comes back to your question, and when I'd finished the answer, I thought, well, I could have mentioned this, so I'm particularly glad you brought this up. Some small states, and considerably smaller, most of them considerably smaller than TNT, the public accounts committees do co-opt non-members of parliament to help flesh out their committees, recognizing that that there are not enough members to, or the members don't have sufficient time to devote to committee duties. Very small states, like the Channel Islands, Jersey and Guernsey in the British Isles, or like Kiribati and Tuvalu in the Pacific, they do have non-members of parliament serve on the committee, usually as full members of the committee with voting privileges, sometimes without voting privileges, but to support the work of the committee. In fact, I think it's really interesting that, I mean, I did say that I get really excited by public accounts committees, so, and I like telling my Westminster friends in London, who say, who are so proud that the first public accounts committee was established by Gladstone in the UK House of Commons. And I say, no, actually, it wasn't. And they sort of look a little shocked. And I say, no, the first public accounts committee was established in Finland 10 years before. And they look a bit surprised. And then I say, not only that, but in Finland, they have a particular model where half the members of the committee are not members of parliament. They're appointed by parliament to serve on the committee, to do this, and they have the same mandate as any other public accounts committee. And that dates back to the mid-19th century, when Finland was a poor agricultural country, and there wasn't expertise in parliament that they felt was needed on the public accounts committee. So I think that's a great idea, and a number of small jurisdictions around the world are beginning to look at this and adopt this as an option.
Okay. I think there was someone else with a hand up.
My name is Kenneth Subran. And I think you missed out an important point in Trinidad, and that is the relationship between cabinet and the public service. In Trinidad, we're supposed to have an independent public service. This has been gradually destroyed by removing contract workers and temporary workers from the protection of our service commission. And they are at the mercy of the politicians. This independent public service is supposed to continuously review their performance and report to cabinet through their ministers. And if these reports are made available to these committees, they will be able to do a much better job. Not only that, the time utilized by parliamentarians in doing research would be considerably reduced. One of our best lawyers here, who was assassinated not too long ago, Dana Caesar, wrote a report that wasn't in newspapers, but had been taken off the internet for some strange reason. And that analyzed the work done by our parliamentarians to indicate that a lot of them do not qualify for remuneration, especially what she called constituency work. And one thing we must bear in mind, the salaries enjoyed by our parliamentarians are full-time salaries. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I didn't quite get the last part of that.
Salaries they collect represent full-time employment.
On the first part of the question, I'm going to defer to your colleagues in the room who know far more about the Trinidad and Tobago situation than I do. But since you bring up the question of salaries, I was working with the London School of Economics a number of years ago on behalf of Commonwealth Parliamentary Association headquartered in London, and we were trying to come up with some sort of benchmark for MP salaries, a very contentious issue in most countries, but we find MP salaries vary across, we were looking at Commonwealth countries, so only Commonwealth countries, from a couple of thousand dollars, US dollars a month, to in the case of Kenya, and now MP salaries have been increased even further, to something like $20,000 a month. So within this huge discrepancy, one wants to come up with, well, what's reasonable? We don't have a marketplace for MP salaries as we have for doctors or lawyers or nurses. They more or less work in a free market, and their salary is what the market will bear, where supply and demand crosses for economists in the audience. We don't have that for members of parliament. So what should an MP salary be? The study that we did, and I just talked to CPA a couple of weeks ago, and they said, look, this should probably be updated, and I would agree. But back 10 years ago, and with lots of caveats, the very tentative conclusion was that a reasonable benchmark might be, you'll notice I'm really covering myself here, might be MP salaries should be about equivalent to that of a High Court judge, and that cabinet ministers' salaries should be about equivalent to Supreme Court judges. Now, having said that, I don't endorse that. I don't know now. I mean, I can't tell you this is what I would propose, but I can say that 10 years ago when we were looking at the issue, there was huge variation. I think $20,000 a month is too high. When I was working at the World Bank, I thought, well, I know what job I want when I retire. I want to be an MP in Kenya. And I think a couple of thousand dollars a month is too low, because if I could earn two or three or four times that in a profession, why would I want to be a member of parliament? I think we're all driven by incentives, and I think that there's a great value in looking at the intrinsic value of the work that's done by an individual. And unfortunately, we don't have a market that can help us determine MP salaries.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The two hands up, three hands up. And I think we ought to take one from online as well.
My name is David Small. I'm an independent senator in the parliament here in Trinidad and Tobago. The obvious disconnect between in the data you presented between what exists in terms of the oversight tools and then the relative effectiveness and obviously the ranking on the, it tells us that the model, somewhere around the model, there's a flaw. The model isn't being applied properly or it isn't working. I partly agree with your hypothesis, but I want to ask, when you looked at the sizes of the committees, did you look at the composition, the number of, because we have in Trinidad, we have government members, opposition members, and in some of the committees, we have independent senator members. So that where you have a situation where all of the committees are dominated or controlled, let's say by the government having a majority, could that be a factor in those committees not really doing the work? Because at the end of the day, I have chaired or vice-chaired one of the couple of these committees. And some of the things coming out of there could be a little embarrassment to the government. Yeah, and that's the reality. So that if you have a situation where a government member is a chair of a committee and something doesn't throw it into a good light, could that be a factor? And if that's the case, just bear with me. Perhaps along the lines of what Mr. Hammond-Smith proposed, and I think proposed, that we need to look at removing or having a different structure for these committees, because it's difficult and logistically for a cabinet member to be an MP, a cabinet member, and then be the chairman of a committee. It's difficult, just logistically in terms of time. So that when we're looking at a model, I think we really need to look at the way it's composed. Yeah, thank you.
Again, I think a very pertinent question for TNT, and one where I'm a little reluctant to jump right in, not knowing the debate that's been going on. But I would say, and I've only been looking at financial oversight committees. So I don't want to talk about the departmental committees, the sectoral committees, the other joint standing committees here. Just looking at the financial oversight committees, I think the evidence is clear that you want to ensure that the opposition is not, the opposition's views in the committee are not squashed. That you don't have a government chair and a government majority of members on the committee, and the committee works to make sure the government isn't embarrassed. And I think that in most countries of the world that have PACs, the chair is from the opposition. That seems to work. In countries which have a chair of the opposition, it seems to me, without having done statistical analysis, this seems to be an important factor that contributes to the effectiveness of the committee. The other is making sure that there's sufficient opposition members on the committee. I think oversight works best when opposition and government are more or less equal. We were talking about that this afternoon with Audley Shaw, the former or current chair of PAC in Jamaica. And my view is that, or our view was, that when there's more or less a balance within parliament, among main political parties, and that's reflected in committees. You have a committee of 10. If you have 9 government members and you have 1 opposition member and the committee is chaired by a member of government, you're not going to get very effective oversight under most circumstances. If you have an opposition chair and you have 6 government members and 4 non-government members, I think you have a very good chance of having an effective committee.
Thank you. We have a number of persons who raised their hands, but we'd like to just get one or two questions from our listening and viewing audience, which will be read by one of our members of staff. Yeah.
Protocols observed. Good afternoon. My name is Melissa Griffith, one of the corporate communication officers here at Parliament, and I will be fielding questions submitted by members of the media, members of the public via our social media. The first question reads, since parliamentarians have a five-year limit term, how effective are parliamentary oversight committees?
Well, that's the nature of democracy, isn't it? I wouldn't advocate any longer term than 5 years. But this is standard around the world. Where committees are significantly less effective, and this certainly is not the case in TNT, committees are significantly less effective when the membership of the committee changes every year or every 2 years. Membership of committees should be for the duration of that particular parliament, 5 years.
Okay, question number two. Is it not possible for parliamentarians to deliberately prolong the Oversight Committee's meetings and in consequence not come to a conclusion on the subject matter?
Well, I suppose everything and anything is possible. I think it depends on the effectiveness of the chair. And certainly in public accounts committees, most chairs I've talked to are loath to have a majority report and a minority report. I think most would prefer to have a majority and minority report rather than no report at all.
One more.
Question number three from Ms. Lisa Wickham. In your experience, has any country been able to improve its ranking on the Corruption Perception Index through strengthening the functioning of parliamentary oversight committees?
Yeah, actually a number have. And the country that I'm most familiar with, and I would suggest the viewer check Transparency International over the last 5-10 years, Ghana, for example, or the Solomon Islands, two countries that have made great efforts to improve parliamentary oversight and are doing better in terms of control of corruption.
Okay. We had a gentleman with his hand up, and we have the clerk of the house.
Stephen Chris, independent senator. One of the issues I'd like you to address is the question of chairmanship of the committees, in the sense that in our case there is a provision for chairmanships to be mandated by being an independent senator and so on, so as to cater for balance, you know, the committees. Recently there has been an occurrence which suggests that the government side want to hold on to at least two committees and chair them, contrary to the standard practice and contrary to what happened in the last parliament, last regime. Not that that might have worked well in terms of how we were perceived on the corruption index, but the thing is, it is a worrying trend. So I was wondering whether in any of the jurisdictions that you have reviewed, what was the legislation like, or was it a question of, practice, the mores of that particular country in terms of where the chairmanship fell for these committees?
I've only examined for the case of analysis, public accounts or other similar committees. So I've only looked at the financial oversight committees. I haven't looked at others. And I think that where the chair is with the opposition, that is usually written in the constitution or in the act of parliament that establishes the PAC or in the standing orders. In the few cases where it isn't, it's usually by tradition. If it's not within one of those documents, it's by tradition. It's relatively rare for a parliament to have an opposition chair of the PAC and move to having a member, a government member of the PAC, chair of the PAC. The only country I know that did that is Sri Lanka. There may be others, but that's the only one I'm aware of.
Professor, my name is Rudolph Williams.
What was of interest to me is that when I saw parliamentary oversight, I thought it was how the people are going to get oversight, better oversight of the parliament. Because that is what, from one of the references you made, seems to be extremely important or vital. When you talked about the low trust that the people have in the parliament, because the extent to which I'm suggesting, and I'd like you to give me your thought on this, the extent to which the parliament is not available to the people, the parliament is an insulated group to which the people, in which people cannot intervene as the years go by. They cannot make comments, they cannot make changes, they cannot have an intervention, active intervention in the operations of the parliament, is the extent to which possibly the democracy is being eroded and being corrupted because people who have a seat, they're outside, they stand aghast, they stand silent. So I would like to ask you if you feel there's a correlation between that kind of weakness of a democracy and the corruption that you talk about.
Okay.
Well, I'm really sorry, time's up and I have to leave. You raise a very important question, and it's one that neither I nor others have studied nearly sufficiently. I think it's one of the gaps in research on parliaments. And I should preface my comments here by saying, you know, there's probably only about a dozen or so people doing serious work, parliamentary research work around the world. There's not many. But nonetheless, thinking about trust in Parliament, I think that the more open a Parliament, the more accessible members of Parliament are, the more that the public are aware of what members are doing, assuming that they're doing good work, then trust in Parliament can increase. I have a suspicion, and it's only a suspicion, that the general public have little idea of what Parliament is or does. They see members of Parliament in debate in plenary, usually shouting or cheering or generally behaving in an excited fashion, shall I say, and they are completely unaware of the work that goes on elsewhere in Parliament. I mean, Parliament has three core functions. It represents the people, it passes legislation, and it holds government to account. I'm completely biased, and I think the latter function is the most important for the reasons I've demonstrated today. And so I think that the more the public can see Parliament conducting oversight, the more it sees the results of that oversight, in other words, lower corruption, the higher the confidence and the trust in Parliament will be. I haven't tested that hypothesis, but that would be my gut feel.
Are you hearing me? Do you think that the Barbados's model for oversight, which includes the involvement of experts outside of Parliament in the overseeing of the financial management of the state, aids its relatively low score that you referred to earlier in relation to corruption?
I knew that Jackie Sampson would ask me a difficult question. I'm really pleased that she hasn't let me down. No, it's much more complex than that, Jackie. I think that, and one of the things that, as I draw these comparisons, and particularly when I said if corruption in Trinidad and Tobago could be reduced to that of Puerto Rico or to Barbados or wherever. I'm trying to give a point of comparison. Certainly the political context, the parliamentary situation in both Puerto Rico and in Barbados and all the other countries that I mentioned are unique to those countries. So it's important that Trinidad and Tobago find its own way, its own model, which takes us back to the heading of the public lecture and all of the activities this week. It's towards developing a model for Trinidad and Tobago, which is Trinidadian and Tobagan. Thank you. It's not to copy any country in the world. That would be a huge mistake. And you'll probably have noticed, and I hope I didn't slip, I've talked about international good practice. I've talked about international good characteristics. I don't talk about best practice, because I don't think best practice works. What works in one country doesn't work in another country. And so what I try to do in the research that I've done and my colleagues do is we try to identify good practice, we try to identify what works in other situations and bring that to audiences like yours and like the Parliament of Trinidad and Tobago for you to say, well, I think this might work here, but that wouldn't, because you're the people who live here. You know your country far better than a foreign expert. And I'm very impressed with the way that I and the other foreign experts have been treated with respect and with consideration of our comments, but with a degree of don't come here and tell us what to do because we know the situation better than you do, which I accept 110%. Our job is to help you, not to dictate or to you. So I think that kind of answers that question.
Professor, my name is Patrick Bino, and I'd like to, first of all, make an observation with respect to your hypothesis and your analysis to say that I pretty much accept it because it has not been proven otherwise.
Yes, that's right. Thank you.
With that opening remark, I'd like to make an observation. You did say that part of the structure is the role of the ombudsman in the democracy. Mm. In Trinidad and Tobago, we have two ombudsmen, financial ombudsman and a public service, ministry ombudsman, where you can go and report incidents related to public disenchantment. Mm-hmm. However, of great interest to me, I made a visit to St. Lucia. And while walking along the street, I saw that they had an office of a parliamentary ombudsman. And I made it my business to make an appointment to see what that ombudsman does. I was given an hour of the ombudsman's time. And I was very amazed. That ombudsman takes all the feedback from citizens related to national issues that might be of their concern that is not being addressed by Parliament. So notwithstanding your observation that they have had 15 years of no committee meetings, zero public accounts meetings, feedbacks, they do have a very strong parliamentary ombudsman process.
Interesting.
And the public is able to come into that office off the street and make any issue known, bypassing the government, bypassing the opposition, and that matter is brought to the parliament through the ombudsman. And to me, that is the strength we need in Trinidad and Tobago. The opportunity for the public to bring their points outside of the media into the parliament directly, through a channel like that. Because our only hope is when we have election and we stain our fingers in red. And at that time, we can change governments. And that only other privilege is if we have an ombudsman where we can come in and make that sort of comment that would make change during the process of Parliament. And to me, that strikes into your model as an alternative, a tweak that could be done in Trinidad and Tobago.
Yeah, that's very interesting. It does sound really interesting, and I wish when I was in St. Lucia, I didn't realize there was such an ombuds office there. I think you summed it up correctly at the end as well. It's not an alternative. It might be something that you wish to look at to tweak what you're currently doing, and would this be effective? And I think that would be a good question for debate, preferably with somebody else as the speaker.
Is the name, and I wanted to take my colleague Ken Subran's point. Thank you, Ken. And to make the point that something that we haven't discussed so far deeply is the impact between the cabinet and the parliament. It's a conflict of interest. It's a vogue term we discuss in the private sector and in the NGO sector and in political writing and so on. But there's a conflict of interest baked in to our constitutional arrangements. The government of the day controls the majority of the parliamentarians. The way things are running in Trinidad and Tobago, it doesn't matter who you vote for. For the last 20 years or more, the bulk of the parliamentarians who are part of the ruling party are members of cabinet. So there you have the executive bulking up the legislature. So you have a kind of a conflict of interest built into, baked into the cake. We need to recognize it. We need to discuss it. I mean, if you look closely at events, you could see it affecting events, what things go forward, what things don't go forward, who is saved an embarrassment, and so on and so on. You can see it. And what do we do about changing it? Do we want to move to a model? We discuss constitutional reform in our country. It's a folk topic, and I know that's not your subject. But we want to get to the point where, in fact, we have a cabinet that, like the United States model, the cabinet is comprised of people who do not come from the parliament. Is that where we want to go? Or do we want to continue with this, where, in fact, the whole cabinet is parliamentarians, and they won't do anything to embarrass themselves, and the rest of the equation could work its way out? Doesn't matter how many committees or meetings you have. That's why our score is so high, because everybody looking out for themselves, A for apple, B for bat.
I wouldn't, for fear of entering into a political quagmire, discretion is the part of valor, and I'm going to be very discreet. But having said that, I would say, and I know this is happening, that there's a very dynamic process underway, and that many issues and many options are being looked at. And I think with a parliament of, 70-odd people, and a third or more of them are cabinet ministers, yes, there's an issue that needs to be addressed. I don't think cabinet ministers would have the time to be able to serve actively on committees. But that's a personal view, and something that you need to discuss and debate. And maybe in my next round of surveys, I'll ask that question.
Good evening, Colin Robinson from CAISO. We've been actively raising the question of the recent shift of four of the oversight committees, not the PSCs, to a cabinet chair and what that means for accountability and functioning. But the broader concern is that we've developed our own model, I think. The two gentlemen who oversaw that, the former leaders of both houses, worked to revise our standing orders. I think it was the first time since independence. So we've come up with, I think it's 11 oversight committees, and now we have four chaired by cabinet members. My question is that, will that work at all? Is the number of oversight committees or that sort of spread, particularly in a smaller parliament, contribute to ineffectiveness? And then you've got almost a third of them being chaired by cabinet members.
Well, then I think you come up to the same conclusion that I did almost, or at least one could make the same argument as I did, but you turn that around. Yes, I mean, I can imagine that ministers don't have much time to serve on committees. Yeah. And I can imagine equally well that members of parliament who only work part-time have even less time to work on committees. So I think these are issues that need to be addressed within the country.
Good afternoon. My name is Rosita Sandford. Acknowledging all that you have said and inform us, but I have a thought that occurred to me a while for all the corruption. You know how First Citizen Bank and all the companies put in the papers all the financial statements. The only financial statement we get from the government is the budget. But I am thinking and envisioning that each, or suggestion, that each parliament member of the give a financial statement to the public in papers. Maybe that would throw off some corruption behavior and make the public aware of how the money's is being spent. I don't know if it's being done, but open it to the public that they know how the money is being done, not only by the budget, and hardly the public knows about the budget. You know, so I'm just envisioning that perhaps that kind of behavior would curb some corruption and we would have a little more trust with the public and Parliament. Thank you.
Without going into too many details, one of the things that an increasing number of countries have done, including my own Canada, is to follow a model initially adopted in the United States to establish a legislative budget office or a parliamentary budget office that operates a little bit like the Auditor General but deals with current issues rather than the completed set of accounts that are then audited. I think this can be a great way for members of Parliament to get information that is current and independent and politically independent, non-partisan, so that they can examine the budget as it's presented in Parliament and ongoing issues regarding public spending. And I know that this is being considered in the Parliament of TNT. In Canada, the Parliamentary Budget Officer was so good at drawing public's attention to government misspending or spending before proposals before it was actually spent. He was so good that the government couldn't wait for his mandate to finish, his term of office to finish, and you've never seen anybody removed from their office as quickly as he was. But I think it's a great idea. It serves members well. I mean, I feel of members of Parliament, and I have no idea, but I suspect that out of the 70-odd members and senators, how many are accountants or financial experts? My guess is not many, and I haven't seen the budget or the public accounts of Trinidad and Tobago, but I would imagine the budget is something like this. Now, first of all, who has the time to read this? And secondly, unless you're an accountant or a financial whiz, how can you understand it? You need somebody who can take this and translate all of these numbers and figures and so on into something that's understandable, that can advise members and indeed the public in terms of this is what this program is going to cost before you make a decision. Yes, let's pass this piece of legislation.
We are coming up onto our allotted time. Would you like to include a question from one of our viewers and or social media persons? And then we'll have a question from the front.
How effective can parliamentary oversight be in an autonomous parliament?
Oh, I think the more autonomous the parliament, autonomous from the executive, the more effective parliamentary oversight can be. I mean, without a shadow of a doubt.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And we have one. What, you have another? Yeah.
Do you think there's a correlation between the increase in compensation for parliamentarians and a reduced level of corruption?
Really good question. And I would think so, but I don't know. I mean, as an analyst, as a researcher, I refrain from giving my personal opinion. And I like to present opinions based on analysis. My suspicion, my hypothesis would be, yes, if you raise members' salaries, then there may be less temptation for corruption. If MP salaries are low, they're going to be tempted to seek other sources of income.
Okay, we have two more questions.
My name is Reginald Armour. I'm an attorney at law, and I also happen to be the president of the Bar Association. Your discussion, understandably, does not include, and I'm putting this out for you to comment on, doesn't include oversight outside of the parliament. And that's understandable because we've inherited a Westminster system and we try to remain faithful to it. So that the English courts have always been reluctant to interfere with and to seek to tell parliament or to question parliament. And there's a lot of case law that has developed that. We've had a situation in the Caribbean which has departed from the English common law quite significantly, in which the Caribbean Court of Justice, which is an independent court, quite independently funded and very independently appointed in Belize, has allowed the Attorney General of that country to bring an action against a member of parliament for misfeasance in office. That significantly departs from the way the English courts have operated. Do you have any comment on that as to the effectiveness of that being part of the oversight that the people can have over parliament?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with that case at all. So I don't wish to comment on it. But I would like to go back to something that that was asked earlier that I'd like to elaborate on. And yes, I think it is important that governments are accountable to parliament. Who are parliamentarians accountable to? Clearly, the public, the electorate. There have been, in other countries, there have been a number of NGOs and other organizations established to monitor parliamentary performance and parliamentary activities. But you get some strange results. In one country, which I won't mention, there's a very active NGO that monitors members of parliament and actually does a scorecard for each member every year in terms of how often did they turn up in parliament, probably a good idea, the number of committee meetings they went to and the number of committee meetings they missed, also probably a good idea, but also the number of times, the number of words spoken by that member in the chamber. Well, that's probably not such a good idea because now in that country, members talk for hours knowing that that's going to increase their score on the scorecard. So we have to be careful what we're measuring.
You'll have the final question. This is one of our other facilitators during this week.
Thanks very much, Rick. I know you're tired, so I'm Jeff Dubrow, by the way. I know you're tired, so I didn't want to pose a question as much as offer a bit of support around some of the issues about cabinet members chairing committee, if you don't mind.
Okay, by all means.
A couple of comments, and I put them on my BlackBerry, so I'm not checking my email as I'm talking to you. With respect to, you know, Rick's talked about public accounts committees, and there's been some questions regarding other committees and the role of other committees. With respect to the joint select committees, again, our job is not to enter into domestic discussions, but really to provide some perspective about what other jurisdictions are doing. I'm not aware of another jurisdiction where a cabinet minister would chair a parliamentary committee. That's not something that would be. Well, I'm just sharing the perspective with you. Generally, I think that's a practice that would be defined as fairly difficult to have a cabinet minister chairing a parliamentary committee. Committees are supposed to be masters of their own destiny. So to have a cabinet minister chairing a committee, I think would make it very difficult to in terms of the effectiveness of that particular committee. I know that in the Caribbean there is certainly a potential role for independent senators, particularly when their appointment is for the duration of the parliament, to play more of a role, and I think that's something that couple of Pan-Americas conferences that I was involved in, there has been discussions about the potential role of independent senators and enhancing that role. And government members, but we talked about cabinet ministers, government members around the world do chair parliamentary committees, and there's nothing wrong with a government backbencher chairing a parliamentary committee. I agree wholeheartedly with Rick that unequivocally, and I could give you a very tangible example, but unequivocally, the Public Accounts Committee, the global standard with the exception of Australia, is that the opposition does chair the Public Accounts Committee, and there's good reason for that. But when it comes to other parliamentary committees, there's nothing stopping a government member from being the chair. In fact, that tends to be the norm in most legislatures. But those are private members, backbench members, not cabinet ministers. One of the things that I think also is important about cabinet is, and this came up at a conference, a Parliamentary conference, oddly I think you were at that conference, 2014, a regional conference, about the size of cabinets in the region. Like, it's not a coincidence that you've got, 23 government members, and how large is the cabinet? 23, right? So it makes it very difficult. There was some discussion about managing the proportion or capping the proportion of cabinet ministers to overall members of parliament. And you're seeing now, I see in Canada, for example, at the provincial level, and I mentioned that because the populations are smaller, that because of the economic recession, the cabinets that are being appointed are relatively small, 12 members, 15 members. So I was laughing when I heard Guyana had 30 cabinet ministers with 750,000 people, and a jurisdiction like Alberta with several million had 12 cabinet ministers appointed after the recent election. So I think the proportion of cabinet ministers could be something that could be discussed. In particular, obviously the advantage to having every member in cabinet is that they are bound by cabinet confidentiality. So and they've got, of course, support the government on all occasions. So, but the detraction is that everybody's in cabinet, there are no private members, and that really does undermine, that's a factor though that could be looked at, is capping that number of cabinet ministers relative to the overall number of government backbenchers. Let me try to get through just a couple more really quick points. Just very quickly, this is gonna be up, as I mentioned today in the training session that I did, it'll be up with regards to the number of select committees currently in the Parliament of Trinidad and Tobago. Have to stop? No problem. Okay. No. I'll just say very quickly with respect, that'll be, I think you have an experiment now with respect to whether that many committees can function in a parliament of this size. Sorry? Give up the mic? Oh, sorry, security's coming to escort me. Whether that experiment works or not is something that you'll have to determine on your own. But you wouldn't find another jurisdictions in the Caribbean such a large number of committees that actually function. So it's something to bear in mind. But congratulations on a great lecture, Rick. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I was going to say put your hands together for Professor Stapenhurst, but you can do it again. Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. It now falls to me after that great interaction to introduce, to give the vote of thanks, our other presiding officer, which is the Speaker of the House, the Honorable Bridget Anderson Jones. Please put your hand together.
Thank you, Chair. Senator Christine Kangaloo, President of the Senate, Cabinet Ministers and Ministers of State, members of the Senate, members of the House of Representatives, specially invited guests, permanent secretaries and heads of government agencies, members of the media, members of staff at the Office of the Parliament, ladies and gentlemen, and may I not forget the members of our listening audience. We have come to the end of a very interesting evening, and I enthusiastically embrace the opportunity to thank Professor Rick Stapenhurst for his erudite lecture on the Oversight Committee System in Trinidad and Tobago. Professor Stapenhurst has presented us with scientific data and his professional evaluation and assessment of our current oversight structures. Professor Stapenhurst has underscored the inverse relationship which exists between corruption and economic growth and development, and he has reminded us that our country's ranking on the Transparency International's Corruption Perception Index has slipped over the past decade. However, the professor's presentation should have given to us hope, as he has demonstrated that with effective parliamentary oversight, levels of corruption have decreased, and relating that solution to Trinidad and Tobago, we have been heartened to learn from the comparison of our committee system with other larger democracies, we have all the requisite structures and tools. And without contradicting the professor, I think we have all the tools, as our motions in the motions on the adjournment serve a similar function to interpellations. Indeed, we have our unique characteristics, as shall exist in any other society. Those unique characteristics, such as low public trust, part-time parliamentarians, and others, affect the optimization of the functionality and the effectiveness of our oversight committees. This Parliament wishes to assure its largest stakeholder, that is, the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, that it is committed to the improvement of our oversight function in spite of our unique characteristics. And this week of activities, which comprises not only this public lecture, is aimed at educating you and engaging you in our attempts to get it right. May I be permitted the liberty to advise that our week of activities also caters for workshops with parliamentarians and the parliamentary staff, aimed at strengthening our capabilities and efficiency, and also includes a panel of reputable and experienced citizens in a discussion on crafting our own unique, improved, and effective model. Your presence at this public lecture is comforting, and your keen participation in the question and answer segment manifests, firstly, that there is public interest in what our Parliament is doing, and also that the relationship between Parliament and the public needs to be fostered. The Parliament's Strategic Plan 2013 to 2018 has identified among its objectives building Parliament's outreach. Indeed, Parliament must actively seek to encourage and strengthen its relationship with civil society. And if I recall a comment coming from the floor, I believe it's Mr. Patrick Bainu, who referred to the ombudsman, parliamentary ombudsman in St. Lucia. I think our Parliament has tried to engage the public through the technology. And the Parliament's website tries to seek from our public the opportunity for feedback. My own view is that a lot of our public has not looked at the technology, has not looked at opportunities presented. While I'm heartened by your presence here, if I just look at taking this as a percentage of the population, we wonder sometimes how much more can we do to engage our public. But we continue on, we would not give up the struggle. Professor, directly to you, your assessment was timely. It closely followed the period when our Parliament declared its desire for the improvement of scrutiny of the government by the expansion of the oversight committees to 12. We are indeed grateful for the work you've done. As we further with Professor Stapenhurst and other international experts, we will continue to share our findings with you, the public. And again, if I recall, there was a comment by Ms. Rosita Sandiford. And I want to remind all our listeners that apart from the PAC and the PAEC, there is also the PAAC, which really looks at real-time expenditure. The professor spoke of the public budget office, or the parliamentary public office, and in terms of that, I want to say that our parliament is currently looking at options to see how we will strengthen the PAAC. It's a new committee. In fact, I see the former speaker, Mark, here, and it would have been under his stewardship as speaker that this committee was formed, so that the committee is going to be tested for the first time in this parliament, and we are looking at several options to provide that committee with the support for it to look at real-time expenditure. And as we say, we intend to keep our public engaged, so both through the technology and opportunities like this, we shall keep you all abreast of developments. Before I close, it will be remiss of me if I fail to recognize that many persons would have contributed to making this week of activities and this event a reality. I wish to thank Madam President, Senator Christine Kangaloo, for her support and participation in the undertaking of this very important initiative. In 2014, parliamentarians amended the standing orders to enhance parliamentary oversight and to provide the necessary support to enable our stakeholders and citizens at large to have enhanced rules in supporting the committee process. I see some of those members present this evening, and I take this opportunity to thank all members of the last parliament for their determination in getting these committees on stream and affecting the amendments to the standing orders. I thank those members of the current parliament who are here with us and who have shared in this experience. And I trust that they would embrace the opportunities that will be made available to them during this week of activities to participate even further in strengthening these initiatives. To the various stakeholders present here, thank you for your attendance. You are all an integral part of the oversight process, and we hope that this lecture has provided you with a deeper understanding of your role in the process. I will also like to thank the members of the media for their continued support of the work we do here at the Parliament. And I would also like to make mention that there is also included a special workshop for the media for them to understand the oversight function and the committee systems of Parliament. All the events planned took considerable time and effort. And in launching this week of events, I cannot help but acknowledge the efforts and the work of the staff of the Parliament. And therefore, I express gratitude to all those who have supported us in practical ways from behind the scenes, the administration, the staff, the tireless procedural clerks, the Parliament police, and the other support staff. Thank you very much. Please be assured that we are deeply appreciated of your assistance. As indicated before, we have our activities this week, which involve other persons who have possibly taken time off for their Christmas vacation to share in this experience with us. We have with us Mr. Geoff Dubrow, who you just met. He's a governance consultant who has worked with us in this region through PAL Americas and the World Bank. We have Mr. Audley Shaw, chair and long-serving member of the Jamaica PAC and a member of the PAAC. We also have Dr. Janine Comer, who is the CEO, director of the Cavell School of Business of the University of the West Indies. And we also have Dr. Justin Robinson, Dean of the Faculty of Social Sciences of the University of the West Indies Cavell Campus. My sincere appreciation for your time, effort, and expertise in helping Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean at large. So against the background of this evening's lecture and discussions, we embark on the week of activities under the theme, Parliamentary Oversight, a Model for Smaller States. We leave here with one unchallengeable conclusion. Parliament oversight matters. And with will, determination, and support, we shall get it right with our own unique model. I thank you, and I take this opportunity to wish you all Happy New Year 2016.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, you've been a beautiful audience. Thank you very much for your participation. You've made this event very interactive. It is just at 7 o'clock now, so we've remained faithful to the time that we had allotted. I will use the words of various speakers before me. This sitting is now adjourned. Thank you very much, Ian.
This has been a presentation of the Parliament Channel and Parliament Radio 105.5 FM.